Hello everyone, I am Sukanya Roy and once again I welcome all of you to the online biology classes for HS second year. So this is the final lecture on the chapter Bioresources of Assam, and here we are going to discuss about the remaining portions from the topic Bioresources of Assam. So let us start with our today's class. In the previous class, we had started with the topic of sericogenic resources of Assam, okay, which refers to the resources or the living resources or the bioresources of Assam which are involved in the production of the silk. Okay, so basically we were studying about the different types of silkworms. So in this lecture we are going to continue with the sericogenic resources of Assam. Clear? So at the very beginning we are going to learn about what is Muga culture. So do you remember in the previous lecture we had studied about the Muga silkworms? So what are Muga silkworms? These are those type of silkworms which are involved in the production of Muga silk. Okay, so what is Muga culture? The Muga culture is defined as a process of cultivation or rearing of the Muga silk moths, that is Anthuria assamensis, and the production of Muga silk. That means the production of Muga silk and the rearing of the Muga silkworm is together termed as the Muga culture. So here are two pictures where the larval stage and the adult stage of the Muga silkworms are depicted. So this is the larval stage of the Muga silk moths, which are generally green in color, okay, and this is the adult or the matured stage of the Muga silk moths, that is the Muga silkworms at their matured or the adult stage looks something like this. Clear? Now let us study about the life cycle and culture of the Muga silkworms. So at the very beginning you should know some of the important points regarding the Muga silk moths. So this type of moths are multivoltine in character. So what is multivoltine? This means that the Muga silkworms actually have more than two generations or broods per year. Okay, so any type of organism which generally has two or more broods or generation in 1 year is termed as multivoltine. Clear? So the Muga silkworms are multivoltine and generally they breed for about 4 to 5 times per year. Clear na? The entire life cycle actually lasts for about 50 days in the summer and about 120 to 150 days in winter for the Muga silkworm. Okay, now see, the life cycle of the Muga silkworm consists of 4 main stages. Basically these are the eggs, the larva, the pupa and the adults. Okay, so here is a diagram. You can see at the very beginning the eggs are laid. Okay, so these are the eggs. Then the next stage is the larval stage, which is followed by the pupal stage. Okay, and ultimately the adult moth comes out. So this is the entire life cycle of the Muga silkworm. So in the local language, the eggs are termed as coney, larva are termed as polu, pupa, which is covered by cocoon, that is this structure, is termed as lata, and the adult moths are termed as the chakari. Okay, so this is termed as the chakari. Now let us have a detailed explanation about the life history of the Muga silk. So at the very beginning you can see that the descriptions about the eggs are given. So a female moth generally after mating lays about 250 eggs approximately. Clear? Then these eggs are collected, okay, and they are sterilized with the help of 2% formalin to prevent any types of diseases. Clear? Next, what happens? The larval stage arrives. It actually takes about 7 days in summer and 15 days in winter approximately for the eggs to hatch out and the larva, the small larva, to come out of the eggs. Clear? Then what happens, as soon as the eggs are hatched out, they are fed on the leaves of the primary host plants. So do you people remember the primary host plants for the Muga silkworm? They were soam and swallow plants, right? So just after the Muga silk larva comes out of the eggs, they are fed upon the leaves of the primary host plants, that is soam and swallow plants. Clear? So this larval stage basically lasts for about 1 to 3 months, and what happens is the larva actually grows in size, and it undergoes different molts, generally 4 molts. It undergoes about 4 molts. That is, this one is the first stage of the larva, which is termed as the first instar larva. Okay, it is very small in size. After that, it changes its size and shape, and it undergoes molting. Okay, and then it gets converted into second instar larva, which is a bit larger in size than the first instar. And then the second instar larva again undergoes molting once again, and it gives rise to the third instar larva, which is a bit bigger in size compared to the second one. And ultimately, like this, the fourth and ultimately the fifth instar larva comes out, which is the most mature form of the larva. Okay, so this moltings are basically nothing but a process under which the larva actually grows in size. Clear? So ultimately the fifth instar larva comes out, which is the most mature stage larva, and the fully grown larva of the Muga silkworm is generally green in color. Have you seen this one is green in color? So this is the fully mature or grown larva. And then the third stage, that is the stage of pupa, arrives. When this is the pupal stage, okay, when what happens, the larva actually starts secreting some substances around it, and it forms a structure or an encasement, okay, termed as cocoon. The cocoon formation is completed generally within 3 to 4 days. Now this one is a cocoon, okay, and it generally forms within 3 to 4 days, and then the larva is completely covered by the cocoon. What happens then, the larva completely covers itself with the cocoon, and then once it is completely formed, the larva gets converted into the next stage, which is termed as pupa. Okay, so this may take generally 15 days, about 15 days in summer and about 60 days in winter. Clear? Then the last stage arrives, when the pupal stage, from the pupal stage, the silkworm actually gets converted into the adult stage. Here what happens, this stage generally takes about 2 to 4 weeks, and then the adult moth comes out of the cocoon. Clear? Then what happens, this process of coming out of the adult moth generally takes place during the dusk time, and just after one day, means like just after coming out, they are actually subjected to mating, and about one day after the mating, the female moths start laying eggs, and they continue to do so for about 3 to 4 days. So here you can see that from the pupa or the pupal stage, the next stage, that is the adult moth stage, has arrived, and it is the male moth, it is the female moth, and then what happens, once again there is mating, and after mating, or after about one day of mating, the female moth starts laying eggs, and ultimately the life cycle is repeated. So this is all about the description of the life history or the life cycle and culture of the Muga silkworm. I hope it is clear to all of you. Let us now move to the next topic, which is the diseases and pests of the Mucha silkworm. So every year during the culture and rearing of the Mucha silkworms, they are being attacked by a large number of harmful organisms and pests, and which in turn causes different types of diseases in them. So one of the most important and serious diseases of the Mucha silkworm is the pebrine disease, which is caused by a protozoan named as Nosema species. So here is a diagram. You can see the conditions of the larva of the Mucha silkworm. Actually, the exposed surface area of the larvae shows some black colored spots, okay, and ultimately the condition of them becomes like this and they dies off. Okay, so the infected late stage larva shows some black colored spots, and in the Assamese language this is termed as futuka, which means spotted disease. Okay, because the bodies in this disease, the bodies of the larva shows some black colored spots on the external surface, and so it is termed as futuka or spotted disease. Clear? Now let us have a look at the control measures or the preventive measures of this disease. So what happens, just after the eggs are laid by the adult moth, they are surface sterilized with the help of 2% formalin for a time of about 5 minutes. Okay, and also the disinfection of the different types of rearing appliances are used, and also the proper hygienic condition is maintained in the egg production room and the other rearing areas. And if any type of prior symptoms or the pebrine spores or the spores of the protozoan Nosema are detected in any crop, then the entire infected crop should be rejected or discarded, so that the disease does not spread among the other nearby crops and healthy crops. Okay. Now let's move to the next type of disease of the Mucha silkworm, which is termed as fletchery, and it is commonly caused by a virus, and which is then followed by a secondary infection caused by a bacteria. Okay. Now in the local language, this disease is termed as Mukh Laga, and this disease generally occurs during the summer season. And during the disease, what actually happens is the larva of the Mucha silkworm, they become very much lethargic, and they almost stops to move. Okay, they stop eating, and ultimately the infected larva dies within a very short time. So you can see a condition of the larva which are affected by the disease fletchery. So the green color, have you seen it? It has converted to a pale yellowish type of color. Okay, and ultimately this larvae stop moving, stop eating, and ultimately they dies off. So here also, just after the eggs are laid, they are washed off properly and sterilized with the help of 2% formalin. Then proper hygienic conditions are maintained at the rearing sites. Also, the different appliances which are used for the rearing and culturing of the Mucha silkworms are also properly disinfected, and different types of antibiotics are used against the bacterial infection, and use of the disease-free varieties of moths are generally done. Okay, if any of the moths are infected, then the entire crop is discarded, and only the healthy and the disease-free varieties are selected for the next cycle of culture. Okay, so here are the important pests of the Mucha silk moths. So what do you mean by pests? Pests are those animals, they can be either plants or animals, which are harmful to the human beings. So here they are actually pests of Mucha silk moths. That means the harmful organisms which can attack the Mucha silk moths. Okay, so these are different types of flies, ants, rats, wasps, cockroaches, etc., which can cause great harm to the entire crops of the Mucha silkworms. Okay. Okay, now let us move to the next part of the lecture, that is the agriculture. So what do you mean by this agriculture? This is the culturing and rearing of the eri silk moths, and the production of eri silk is together termed as the agriculture. So this is the scientific name of the eri silk moths. In the last class also we have seen that it is termed as Philosemia ricini, or sometimes it is termed as Semia ricini as well. Okay, so what is agriculture? It is the combined term, okay, of the process of culturing of the eri moths and the production of eri silk out of them. So here are two pictures where you can see the larval stage of the eri silkworm is shown. This is the exact structure or exact picture of how a fully grown larva of eri silkworm looks like. Okay, and this one is a picture of a adult moth of the eri. Okay, or adult eri moth. Clear? Now let us have a look at the life history and culture of the eri silkworm. So this moth is also a multivoltine species. We had already seen that. What is multivoltine? This is a term which is given to any type of species which can have more than two generations or broods per year. Okay, so in case of the eri silkworm also, they can have about 6 life cycles approximately per year, and so they are also termed as multivoltine. And their entire life cycle generally lasts for about 85 to 87 days in winter season, while they last for about 50 days approximately in summer seasons. Clear? The entire life history of the eri silkworm also has 4 different stages. The first is the eggs, the larva, and the pupa, and the adults. So here is a picture depicting the life cycle of the eri silkworm. It starts with the egg, okay, then the larval stage, then the pupal stage, which is the pupa is generally covered by the cocoon. So here it is written as cocoon. And ultimately the last stage, that is the adult moth stage, which in turn ultimately gives rise to eggs once again, and then the cycle continues. Clear? Let us have a look the detailed structure of the life cycle of the eri silkworm. So first of all, a female moth generally after mating lays about 500 eggs approximately, and the hatching of these eggs generally takes about a period, time period of about 8 to 20 days. Then the next stage, that is the larval stage, comes in, where the hair like newly hatched larva are formed, which are generally yellowish in color. They are fed upon the leaves of the host, primary host plant. So what is the primary host plant of the eri silkworm? It is the castor plant. Okay, the scientific name for castor plant is Ricinus communis. Okay, so they are just after their hatching, the newly formed small larva are fed upon the leaves of the primary host plant, that is the castor leaves. And then the moltings, the larva actually undergoes 4 times of molting, and which takes for about 30 to 32 days. And then the spinning of the cocoon, that is the third stage, is going to get started. Okay, then the pupal stage lasts for about 15 to 37 days. And during this period, what happens? The larva changes to the next stage, that is termed as pupa. Pupae is the plural form. Okay, a pupa is then covered by a hard integument inside the cocoon. What is the function of cocoon? It protects the pupa from any types of external injury, okay, or any type of predators. The last stage is the adult stage, where the adult moths actually comes out, and their wings actually show some prominent kind of eye spot. Okay, you can see here, can you see these eye spots are there, some spot like eyes, okay, some spots actually resembling eyes, so they are termed as eye spots. So you can see the wings have eye spots. Then just after emerging out, they start mating, and then they start laying of their eggs. Clear? And then the life cycle is repeated. So here is a diagram which depicts the entire life history of every silkworm. Let's just take a look. So this is the egg, okay, which hatches out, and then the first stage larva comes out. It's very small in size. Then it undergoes first molting and grows in size, and then it is termed as the second stage larva or the second instar larva, okay. Then it undergoes the next molt, then it grows in size even more, and it is now termed as the third stage larva. After that, then similar types of molts occur, and ultimately it reaches the fifth stage larva, larval stage. It is the most mature or the fully grown form of the larva of the eddy silkworm. And then the third stage, that is the pupal stage, comes in when the larva forms a cocoon surrounding it and gets converted into pupa. After that, from the pupa, the adult moth comes out. Then the males and the females undergoes mating, and then again they start laying the eggs. The female moths start laying the eggs, and this is how the entire life cycle is repeated. I hope it's clear to all of you. Once again, the important diseases and pests of the eddy silkworms. So this here also, the eddy silkworms also undergo different types of diseases, and these are almost the same. The diseases are almost the same in case of all the silkworms. So already we have studied about the pebrine disease caused by Nosema, and here some black spots are black spots or dots are being seen on the external surface of the larva, and they are generally controlled by surface sterilization with the help of formalin, and proper hygienic conditions are being maintained. And if any type of symptoms are seen, then the entire crop should be rejected. Okay. The next is the fletchery. Already we have studied about it. It is also commonly termed as muklaga. And here also it's a very dangerous disease. Here the larva actually completely stops their eating process. They stops their movement, and ultimately they dies very soon. So these are the very important pests of the eddy moths, which cause large scale destruction of the entire crop of the eddy silk moths. Some important pests or some remarkable pests are, one of the important one was tachin fly, ants, cockroaches, lizards, spiders, etc. Okay. Well, so we have come to an end of the chapter Bioresources of Assam. So thank you everyone for listening to my class. Study well and do subscribe to my channel for the latest updates on the next classes. Thank you once again.